Heavenly Father, we ask that you would guide our thoughts in this next presentation as we consider the origin of the drumbeat, because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're continuing Audio Invasion, the unseen enemy within. In this class, we are looking at drumming up demons. I went to an Adventist academy when I was in my teen years, small academy in America, and I was not a Christian. I'd been raised as a Seventh-day Adventist, but I rebelled. So as a result, I was living a rotten life, addicted to the music of the world. And I remember one year in academy, we had an outbreak of demon possession. First case was in the girls' dormitory. There was a girl who became demon possessed. She was listening to the rock band Blue Oyster Cult. Then just, I think, the same week, there was a boy in our dorm who became demon-possessed, who was listening to things like Kiss, Led Zeppelin, Rolling Stones, the very same musicians that I was addicted to. And it was at that point that I began to realize that there was a dark side to music that I had overlooked, a side of the demonic. We saw in our last class how that rock music is linked to an elevated cortisol, that's your stress hormone. And in this class, we're going to see a link between rock music and demon possession, demon worship. Here's a statement from a doctor on music, Dr. Juanita McElwain. She taught music. She was a professor of music at several different universities. And she said the same exact rhythms are used in each of the three religions. In African and Indian music, I've been to India, same rhythms in India. In rock music, and in music used in meetings of faith healers. The God, that's a demon, comes whenever he is called by anyone using those rhythms. Does the God, that's a demon, come to celebration-type worship services when the God, the demon's rhythm, is played in Christian rock music, even though the people present do not realize that they're calling a God, a demon? And she says, there is quite a strong consensus that the God, that's a demon, does come. Whether we recognize it or not, when we listen to music that has the rhythms of the ancient gods, we are inviting those demons. And that brings us to the question today, where did the drum and the drum beat come from? The drum was the primary instrument used in the pagan worship of the gods of antiquity. It was also used in many of their rituals and their trances. Again, from Dr. Juanita McElwain, this doctor of music, she said goddesses were a dominant part of the religion of ancient Sumeria. You know where Sumeria was located? That's where Abraham was living, Ur of the Chaldees. That was Sumeria. That's where Babylon came to power. The original Babel builders were in Sumeria. Some of the earliest representations of religious rituals show female performance ensembles of musicians, singers, and dancers. The frame drum or hand drum was at the center of these rituals. These were the original Babel builders. Goddesses, priestesses, and musicians played the hand drum, all women. They used the drum to summon the goddess, and the goddess spoke through the drum. So if you wanted to invite the goddess, what would you use? The drum. The drum was the primary trance-inducing instrument. So if you wanted to fall into a trance, you would use the drum to do so. Here's an interesting picture. And there's a text. You can write down the text if you're taking notes, from Deuteronomy 12, verse 31, where God said, thou shalt not do so unto the Lord thy God, for every abomination to the Lord which he hateth have they done unto their gods. For even their sons and their daughters have they burnt in the fire to their gods. And here's an example of a human sacrifice. The baby is being sacrificed to this pagan idol. And you notice in the background the women with the hand drum. In the foreground, we have the men with the big drum. The drum was used at the center of all these pagan worship services. So the drum originated there. It was originally used in the worship of Babylon. God called Abraham out of Babylon. The drum then moved in time. I'm giving you the history of the drum beat. It moved from Babylon to Egypt. That's why Dr. Gonzalez says Egypt is where modern historians directly trace the origins of rock music. So they trace it to Egypt, but where can you originally trace it to? Babylon, Ur of the Chaldees. God called Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees. Here is, you can see the Egyptians dancing to the drum. Took all their clothes off, or almost all their clothes off. You can get an idea of how this style of music was used in the Egyptian worship. And they would dance to the music because the music made you want to dance. That style of music and rhythm migrated from Egypt over to West Africa and became part of the worship of voodoo, the worship of the spirits. Here is a picture, a painting of the worship of voodoo. Worshipping the spirits. From there, it migrated across the ocean in the slave trade to the West Indies, especially the island of Hispaniola. Today, the center of voodoo worship in the world is in Hispaniola. Haiti came from West Africa and went to the New World. You can see here the voodoo drums. I want to show you a picture of the voodoo drums. This is actually a Christian group using the voodoo drums. Children's choir. Those are the voodoo drums. An example of the voodoo drums. In the language of the Dahomey, that's the African tribes, the word voodoo means gods or spirits. And you know, in our early ancestry, we worshipped the spirits, which were actually demons. Honey Naylor said one of the primary gods was Zambi, also called Dambula, which was a snake, usually a giant python. Among other things, the snake worshippers believed that the first man and woman on earth were blind until the serpent gave them sight. You may have heard of the very famous prophet here in Kenya who was found by his driver in the woods talking to a serpent. Gives you an idea where he gets his power from. So here you have the zombie, the worship of the python. Have you ever said, I feel like a zombie? You don't want to say that, I guess. And you notice that they believed the first man and woman on earth were blind until the serpent gave them sight. And you may remember when Eve ate from the tree, the devil told her that this would be a tree to make one wise, to open their eyes. Yes, Adam and Eve were blind to the consequences of sin. They were blind to the effects of sin until the serpent gave them sight, the sight of evil. And we've been viewing evil ever since. One of the most supreme and powerful laws, that's a spirit, loa, is Dambula Widu, the serpent god. He is represented in voodoo rituals by a snake. The dance with the snake symbolizes the unity between our world and the world beyond. The dancer and the snake become one. This is demon worship. The follower of voodoo, this is from the book World of the Unexplained, the follower of voodoo seeks to incorporate a loa, that's a spirit, lesser god, into himself. This is demon possession. By writhing and leaping through dance, a dance, while drums bang out complex rhythms. And now we're bringing that very same thing into church. When just the right rhythm is found for an individual loa, that's a spirit, the dancer takes it up, and the loa enters his soul. He becomes possessed. The religion is strictly Dionysian, or sensual. That's why it's so attractive. All the feelings that you get when the spirit takes control. So in the ancient worship, they had three things: sex, drugs, and hypnotic music, or the drum beat. And today, in rock music, what do we have? Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. It's the same thing. We've simply modernized ancient pagan demon worship. You may remember that music has three parts: melody, harmony, and rhythm. And rhythm is what speaks to the flesh, speaks to the body, which allows the spirits to take over. To tribal peoples, this is from Michael Venture in the book, Hear That Long Snake Moan. To tribal peoples, religious worship is seen as a bodily celebration. This is why the rhythm beat in their worship music is so accentuated. So out of those three parts of music, they take the last part, rhythm, and they accentuate that to where you want to move because of the rhythm. The goal of African religions is to experience with their bodies the crossroads of the physical and the spiritual worlds, to become possessed. And now we bring it into church. Let me give you an example. This is from South Africa. Not Adventist, but we're not far behind. Look at them dance. This is the choir. The evangelism choir. The words are okay, thinking about Jesus. Are you thinking about Jesus as you listen to that kind of music? Look at those women. Look at the children. You can't sit still to that kind of music. The whole congregation is up on their feet celebrating. This is an experience of the bodies. The goal of African religions is to experience with their bodies the crossroads of the physical and the spiritual worlds, to become possessed. Each percussive, I'm just giving you these quotations, they come from different places. This is from Drum is the Ear of God, Richard Hodges. Each percussive or vocal part has a slightly different rhythm, which coincides with and sometimes crosses the other rhythms, or the guiding pulse at strategic moments. The drummers often shuffle their feet, you saw them there, including the audience, or sway their bodies in dance-like motions to assist them in maintaining contact with the main beat, especially when the rhythm is syncopated. Now our choirs are doing the same thing. During these rituals that still take place in the Congo and Yorubaland, the intricate layers of the multiple rhythmic drumming are considered the primary source of occultic power. We get our power from the spirits through this music, and now we're bringing it into church and putting it on our phones. Are we bringing it into church? That's the source of, according to this, source of occultic power. Here is from a voodoo priestess. The rhythm is more important than the meaning of the words. Our gods respond to the rhythm above all else. Tell me, what gods are those? Those are the spirits, the demons. Doesn't matter what the words are that you put with that music. The gods, the demons, respond to that kind of rhythm, those rhythms. Now, this was the music of Africa. But where did it come from? Did it come from Africa? It came from Babylon. So please remember, if we want to excuse our music based on our culture, we have to remember the culture came from Babylon. How did that music get to the rest of the world? Well, I mentioned earlier how that through the slave trade, voodoo worship came from West Africa to the West Indies. And then it went to America through the gateway of New Orleans. In 1717, there were some, according to some accounts, there were 3,000 African slaves that had been brought to Louisiana from the West Indies. That's from Hispaniola. And then by 1817, they had a place in New Orleans called Congo Square. It was a gathering place of the slaves. And it was here that the African music of West Africa, voodoo music, underwent a transformation. According to Michael Venture in the book, Hear That Long Snake Moan, he says, in the tribal ceremonies, there was no audience. Everyone became a participant. Remember the choir there, or the worship service there in South Africa? Everybody was up dancing. Everyone was participating. But in Congo Square, African music was put into a Western form of a presentation. So you would come and listen and watch the choir. Continuing, it says, now the religious African element still present became a secret within the music rather than the object of the music. Tell me, what was the secret hidden in the music? The African element that was the secret hidden in the music was the goal to become possessed by the spirits. That was the goal. And that was hidden now in the music rather than the object of the music. Because the visible elements of ritual worship were now hidden. What were the visible elements? Demon possession. When you've seen people demon possessed, that's the visible elements. When they fall and they start convulsing and so forth. Because the visible elements of ritual worship were now hidden, a much wider audience could accept African music. But remember, this African music had come from where? Babylon. This is the music of Babylon. From the book Rock and Roll and Unruly History, I read this. African-based drumming, singing, and dancing, discouraged and repeatedly banned elsewhere in North America, had flourished there. Where was there? New Orleans, since the early 18th century. I'm showing you the history of the drum beat. This unique heritage has informed and enlivened New Orleans music ever since, as well as distinguishing it from the rest of American musical culture. There was a unique style of music in New Orleans. Then coming down to the 1840s, a lot of the Africans there in America started turning to Christ and were allowed to have their own churches. You may remember that in America, back in the 1700s and so forth, the Africans were slaves up until Abraham Lincoln, the great emancipator, set them free. And then they became Christians. They started having their own worship, their own churches. 1840s, that's an interesting date for Seventh-day Adventists, right? Some turned away from drums completely. Others incorporated them, the drums, into their new faith. They would sing the same hymns as the Caucasians, but with shouting and beating out counter rhythms on tambourines, gourds, and logs. The voodoo beat. Eventually bringing about the Holy Flesh movement. This is the birth of Pentecostalism. Congregants still sought for possession, only now it was called the the Holy Ghost. They still want to be possessed by the Spirit, but not the demons. Now it's the Holy Spirit. So essentially it's the same Spirit with a different name. This is baptized paganism, essentially. They would speak in tongues, they would roll on the floor, they would, all these sounds. It was just like voodoo, only in a Christian setting. Then coming down to 1877, Thomas Edison invented sound recording. And this would really change the landscape of music. Before then, if you wanted to listen to music, you either had to sing yourself, or you would have to go to the choir, or go to the church, or go to the concert and listen to music. But now they could record the music. And now music began to spread through the recordings, the phonogram, and etc. Into this history of the drumbeat, we need to add an important individual. You may have heard of this man. His name, Aleister Crowley. He lived from 1875 to 1947. How many of you here have heard of Aleister Crowley? Let me see. All right, quite a few of you have. He is considered the father of modern Satanism. When he was married on his honeymoon, he went to Egypt. There in Egypt, he met a Egyptian god. And he wrote the book of the law. This was no doubt a demon that gave him, that inspired him. He founded the religious philosophy of Thelema. He wrote the book of the law, states, "Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law." He said that this book was given to him by his guardian angel, his higher self. This was a demon. This is spiritualism. Included in his book, he expressed views about sex that were radical. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And they go together. And he was a pervert. Aleister Crowley would have sex with anything. A woman, didn't matter whether she was his wife or not. Another man, an animal, anything. That's how perverted he was. He stated that he was in revolt against the moral and religious values of his time. You can see him there. He's got the mark of the beast on his hat. He called himself the beast, the great beast. He is the father of modern Satanism. He was denounced by the popular press of his day as the wickedest man in the world. That's not a very good title, to be called the wickedest man in the world. This is Aleister Crowley. He desired to use music to bring on the New Age. So notice, how did he want to bring in his satanic teachings into the world? Through music. He desired to use an army of youth. God wants to use an army of youth, but so does the devil. To indoctrinate with, what's the theme? Do what thou wilt. Crowley taught that one could become a genius in music through practicing his Satanism. So he essentially said, if you practice Satanism, you will become famous as a musician, rich and famous. And that's exactly what many musicians have done. Well, let's come back now to the drumbeat in history. We're down to the early 1900s. We come down to about 1911 was when this man was born, Robert Johnson. How many of you have ever heard of Robert Johnson? Anyone? I don't see too many hands. He is often considered the first blues man in the chain that ultimately led to rock and roll, because African music in America was called blues music. It later became rhythm and blues music. He did what Aleister Crowley suggested. He began practicing Satanism. Many of his songs refer to his personal deal that he made with the devil. He actually sold his soul to the devil. Let me see if I can... Oops, didn't look like my clip worked. But anyway, he has a song where you can hear him singing, "Me and the Devil, we're walking side by side." He said later, "Everyone knows that you make a deal with the devil down at the crossroads." He literally sold his soul to the devil for success, and he became a very successful musician, Friends and colleagues, though, said that for the rest of his life, he was a tormented soul. He died at the old age of 27. Like so many rock musicians do. Crowley had taught you can become a genius, you can become very successful in music by practicing Satanism, and most of the rock musicians of today have done that. The blues music that came out of Congo Square, New Orleans, glorified drinking, womanizing, gambling, drugs, violence, and depravity. Now tell me, shall we just say, well, that's part of our culture? This is the excuse that I get all the time. People say, well, this is our culture. This music is our culture. Well, if our culture includes drinking, womanizing, gambling, drugs, violence, depravity, shall we continue the culture? It's time to change the culture. And what part of the music is it that causes all these evils? It is the rhythm. Well, rhythm and blues developed into jazz, and unfortunately it crept into even the gospel music of that era. Some of the music, you listened to it, you felt like you wanted to dance to the music. Rhythm and blues. And I don't know why my clips are not working. We'll have to skip over them. Then you come to the 1950s. And when you think about the 1950s, what do you think about? Rock and roll. That's where it developed. In 1954, Bill Haley and the Comets began writing hit songs. They were a white band using black-derived forms, rhythm and blues. Rhythm and blues music was considered black music. And you understand that in the 50s in America, there was a very strong racial prejudice. It's really not so much there today, but back in the 50s, there was this lot of prejudice between blacks and whites. And so the whites would not listen to rhythm and blues because that was considered black music. But then they changed the name of rhythm and blues to rock and roll. And so it became popular among white audiences. And Bill Haley, with his Rock Around the Clock, that became one of the great hit songs of the era. Rock music was popular with teens wanting to break out of the conservative American mold. It was considered decadent, dangerous, immoral, and obscene. Shall we bring that into church? And there was a good reason why people were against that style of music back then, because it had a licentious effect upon the people. And you can see back in the 50s, the effect of that particular music. There's a book entitled Memphis Beat. And Memphis was where a lot of music had its origins in America. In the book, the author talks of a part of Memphis that was involved in immorality, Mill Street. This is where the houses of prostitution, the taverns, and the gambling places were. He states that there was always a certain type of music at Mill Street. This is what he says: the forbidden pleasures of Mill Street always, always come wrapped in the pulsing rhythms of the blues. And now we're bringing those rhythms into church. Then you come down in history to Elvis Presley, considered the king of rock and roll. This is classic rock. Elvis Presley. That's classic rock. Pretty mild compared to some of the music of today. Elvis Presley, he brought together country, pop, and rhythm and blues in a way that had never been done. He made the guitar the focal instrument there in the concert. Before it had been the piano, but now he made it the guitar. At Elvis' live shows, the influence on the audience became increasingly fervent. They wouldn't sit and listen. When they would hear the music, they were up on their feet, dancing. Reports stated he'd start out, "You ain't nothing but a hound dog," and they'd go to pieces. They'd always react the same way. There'd be a riot every time. Sounds like my clip didn't work. I updated some of my slides, and apparently I lost the links. Then came the Beatles, 1960s. They were one of the most successful acts in history, Beatlemania. In fact, if you look at rock groups' success in history, the Beatles are still number one on the charts for success in sales. Even though they were disbanded many, many years ago, they are still the best-selling rock group of all time, Beatles. Their influence extended into the social and cultural revolutions of the day. Our music, they said, this is what Lennon said, our music is capable of causing emotional instability, disorganized behavior, rebellion, and even revolution. Beatle music. Pretty mild today. Classic rock. In 1967, they produced the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band album. It is considered the number one rock and roll album of all time. It went to the top of the charts in the UK and spent 27 weeks there. Almost a half a year. That's unheard of. It spent 15 weeks at the top of the chart in America. Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, 1967, considered the greatest rock album of history. And as you look at the picture there, you can see all these friends of the Beatles. In the background, this is a collage of their best-loved heroes. If you see the back on the back row, there is Aleister Crowley, that Satan worshiper who said that if you practice Satanism, you'll become successful in music. There's a picture of him. You can see there. He's on the back of this album. Most people believe that Sgt. Pepper is a reference to Aleister Crowley. Sgt. Pepper taught the band to play. 20 years after Aleister Crowley died, he died in 1947. 20 years later, 20 years ago today, the Beatles sang, Sgt. Pepper taught the band to play by worshiping Satan. And that's why the Beatles became so famous. Here's what Lennon said. Christianity will go. It will shrink and vanish. I will be proved right. You just wait. We are more powerful now than Jesus ever was. So that sounds like blasphemy, right? That was Lennon, who is dead now. Died in 1980. The Beatles, this is what their press secretary said. The Beatles are completely antichrist. I mean, I am Antichrist as well, but they are so Antichrist, they shock me, which is not an easy thing to do. Here's what Lennon said. I felt like a hollow temple filled with many spirits. Who's possessing this famous songwriter? Each one passing through me, each inhabiting me for a little time, and then leaving to be replaced by another. Lennon, a demon-possessed musician. Talking on the writing of his songs, he says, I don't know who the blank, curse word, I don't know who the blank wrote it. I'm just sitting and the whole blank song comes out. So as I'm sitting there, it's just like, here's the song. It's like it's handed to me. Who's handing the songs to Lennon? Let me ask you, who was the choir director in heaven? He later shared, I have sold my soul to the devil. And when we listen to that kind of music, we're listening to music that was probably written by the devil himself or one of his demons. In an interview later in his life, Lennon said, the whole Beatle idea was do what you want, right? Do what thou willst. Where did that come from? Aleister Crowley. which was essentially echoing the words of Lucifer in heaven. Do what you want. God should not tell you what to do. You need to have complete freedom to do whatever you want to do, which is rebellion. Timothy Leary, a Harvard professor and Crowley follower, referred to the Beatles as the four evangelists and stated that rock music was as much a deconditioner as psychedelic drugs. And now we're bringing that music into church. It is designed to blow your mind, to suspend your conditioned reflexes. Listening to a Beatles album is an hour of deconditioning. I used to do that, listen to that kind of music. I'd never listen to the words. I mean, half the time you couldn't understand the words anyway. I just listened to the music. And now we're bringing that kind of music into church. Something else Leary said that was very interesting. Don't listen to the words. It is the music that has its own message. And the question is, what is the message of the music? We're going to answer that in our next class. Here's the music. Can you decipher the message? Well, we'll come back to that in next class. But notice something else. Timothy Leary says, I have been stoned on the music many times. The music is what will get you going. You can become high on the music, addicted to the music. We saw how that rock music elevates your stress hormone. It opens the door for demonic influences. That is why Ellen White says Satan takes control of every mind that is not decidedly under the control of the Spirit of God. For thousands of years, Satan has been experimenting upon the properties of the human mind, and he has learned to know it well. By his subtle workings in these last days, when? In these last days, he is linking the human mind with his own. That's spirit possession. Imbuing it with his thoughts, and he is doing this work in so deceptive a manner that those who accept his guidance know not that they are being led by him at his will. Could you be led by the devil and not even know it? It sounds like it. Coming back to the book Rock and Roll and Unruly History, I read this: the idea that certain rhythm patterns or sequences serve as conduits for spiritual energies. It's like a pipe for the energy to flow, linking individual human consciousness with the gods. Ellen White says that the devil links the human mind with his own. And so it says linking the rhythms, linking individual human consciousness with the gods is basic to traditional African religions. The fundamental riffs, licks, bass figures, and drum rhythms that make rock and roll can ultimately be traced back to African music of a primarily spiritual or ritual nature. In a sense, rock and roll is a kind of voodoo. Tell me, voodoo is what? Worship of the spirits, worship of the demons. Little Richard, a rock musician, said, my belief about rock and roll is this. I believe this kind of music is demonic. A lot of the beats in music today are taken from voodoo. This is the admission of a rock musician. He's not an Adventist, not even a Christian. But he's admitting that the music is the music of the devil. Now we're bringing it into church. I was directed and commanded by another power, the power of darkness, the power of the devil, Satan. So he blatantly admits who is controlling him, the devil. Walter Wright, the doctor, says this: the tempo of the voodoo drums has been known to make a listener powerless to resist the music's pounding beat. You lose control. Of course, when you lose control, who takes over? At rock concerts, when the tempo of the music hits a certain pitch, it brings a psychological response which the audience is unable to resist. And now you don't even have to go to the rock concert. You can go to the church. Many churches, you have a rock concert. And when the beat hits a certain level, then you cannot resist the power, the influence. The Seattle Times had an article at the request of the Seattle Times. Dr. Bernard Seibel, child guidance expert for the Washington State Division of Community Services, attended a concert of the Beatles. After the performance, he wrote, "The experience of being with 14,000 teenagers to see the Beatles is unbelievable and frightening. The hysteria and loss of control go far beyond the impact of the music. Many of those present became frantic, hostile, uncontrolled, screaming, unrecognizable beings." What happens when somebody becomes demon-possessed? That's exactly what happens. They become uncontrolled, hostile, screaming sometimes, unrecognizable. They begin, well, you can't control them. "This is not simply a release, as I first thought it would be, but a very destructive process. Normally recognizable girls behaved as if possessed by some demonic urge." Now tell me, when they went to that rock concert by the Beatles, do you think those girls were planning to become demon-possessed? Not at all. But this is the effect of the music upon the girls. "Deifying in emotional ecstasy the restraints which authorities and common sense would place on them." That's why Amazing Discoveries, this is not Amazing Facts, this is another ministry, Amazing Discoveries states, "In this musical environment," that's a rock concert, "listeners can easily slip into a hypnotic, drug and music-induced stupor, losing control of the master brain." What's the master brain? The frontal lobe. "This opens them up to the power of suggestion and lessens their ability to reason. The music becomes the hypnotic tool." What's the tool? The music. Now we're bringing that music into church. "Opening the mind to receive the messages that demons want to implant. Digitize and modernize voodoo music, and you end up with rap." Where's the melody? The harmony? Rhythm? All rhythm. Rap music. When you hear the matatu go by, or the bus go by, what are they playing? Many of them, they're playing rap. "Drums represent the beat of the heart and are played to summon up magic powers." You want to summon up magic powers into your life, into your home, into your church? Martha Bales says, "When the first blacks from Africa were converted to Christianity, they knew the power and influence of the drums. And the converted blacks strictly forbid the use of drums. They referred to the drums as the devil's drum." Now you know, everybody here that's 30 or above, you know, 30 years ago, you can remember when we would not allow this kind of music in church. We wouldn't allow these drum beats into church worship. Yeah, I see some of you remember that. But today, our choirs come in, they put on their recorded music, and here comes the drum beat. Mickey Hart, drummer for the Grateful Dead, said, "Everywhere you look on the planet, people are using drums to alter consciousness. I have discovered, along with many others, the extraordinary power of music, particularly percussion," that's the rhythm, "to influence the human mind and body. There have been many times that I have felt that the drums have carried me to an open door to another world. A world of spirit possession." What carried him there? The drums. "It's hard to pinpoint the exact moment when I awoke to the fact that my music, my tradition, rock and roll, did have a spirit side. That there was a branch of the family that maintained the ancient connection between the drum and the gods." That's the devils, the demons, the rhythm. And now we're bringing all of that into church. Where did the drum come from originally? Babylon. Went from Babylon to Egypt. God called Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees and took him to Canaan. God called his people out of Egypt when they went down in bondage into Egypt. God took them out of Egypt. Today, God is calling his people out of Babylon. Let's not use culture as our excuse to stay in Babylon. God is calling his people out of Babylon. Well, we could continue in the drumbeat of history, but it only gets worse. You go from the blues music to rhythm and blues music. Then came jazz in the early 30s and 40s. Then in the 50s, classic rock. Then in the 60s, the latter 60s, hard rock. Then came heavy metal in the 70s. And from there on, it just gets worse. We have heavy metal. We have black metal. We have death metal. And now we've Christianized every part of that. I'll give you a clip of Christian death metal. This is Christian. You tell me what they're saying. I have no idea what they're saying. That's death metal. Christian death metal. We can't take the world's music and put Christian words with it and call it Christian. It's simply not true. That's the devil's music. So you have today discovered rock and roll, the drum beat, did not originate in Africa. It originated where? In Babylon. God called Abraham out of Babylon. It went from Babylon to Egypt. It went from Egypt to West Africa. It went from West Africa to Hispaniola. It went to New Orleans. And then it spread up to Memphis, crossed over to New York. And from New York, rock and roll has gone to the whole world. Has it come into your church? The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 6, 16 and 17, "Wherefore, come out from among them and be you separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. I will be a father unto you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord of God." Lord God, Lord Almighty, I want to be one of the children of God, don't you? Don't you? How many want to be a child of God? Let me see your hands. We need to ask God to help us leave behind the drumbeat of Babylon and come back to the Christian music of our heritage. Our next class, we're going to be looking at pop music's bad attitude, the rhythm of rebellion, and how the very rhythms that have taken over music actually develop a bad attitude in the person. We'll look at that in our next class.